nothing lifts you higher. Bring me your desire, a passion worthy of your name.
Everyone, and I want to thank you today for joining us for church. My hope today is that God engages you and helps you to steer to the meat of His Word. Here's a few announcements as we get started. I hope that you'll participate with us in worship. And let me encourage you to take out a notebook, jot down some notes from the sermon, because there's going to be a lot of stuff that's going to be thrown at you that I want to help you make sense out of as the Holy Spirit is speaking truth into your life. May God bless you. Enjoy the service, and we'll see you here in a little bit. Before we go into our time of worship, we always have a short call to worship video. But before we do that, allow me to pray with you this morning. Lord Jesus, we come before you this morning so grateful and thankful that you hear us when we pray. We take this opportunity, Lord, to allow you to be all the God that you desire to be in our lives. We take down our walls, our inhibitions. We take down our fears, our anxieties. We take them, Lord, and we lay them at your feet. We lift up our hands asking, Lord, for you to supply what we need in order to do this day-to-day life in this season, in this crazy world we live in. Thank you that you give us eternal life, not life just eternally, but that you are with us. You are God in us each and every step of the way. So whether we're facing crisis of health, loneliness, mental health, whether we're facing crisis in marriage, in finances, you're here and you're not leaving us or forsaking us. Please bless us today in Jesus' name. Amen.
The earth is the Lord's and everything in it. He founded it on the seas and established it on the waters. He holds the mountain in his hands and his love reaches to the depths. The earth, the heavens declare his glory, the skies prepare.
Lord, unto me. great hope for tomorrow. Blessings all mine with 10,000 beside. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father.
Hi, this is Tony from MinistryToChildren.com. In this video, I want to show you an object lesson that I've been using recently in our church here to help kids think about the consequences of sin and righteousness. One of the biggest struggles for me with my own kids and kids in the ministry is how to get a kid to make the choice to do right, even though they don't think no one's going to catch them. So what I'm doing in this object lesson is trying to apply some biblical wisdom about practicing sin and practicing righteousness, and how when you get on one path, it makes it easier and easier to go the wrong way, and how if you get on the other path, it makes it easier and easier to do the right things. So this is not some kind of moralistic lesson, but this is just some realities from life, what happens when we fight sin or we cooperate with sin. So check it out. I'd love to hear what you think. It's kind of like when David first learned to dribble the basketball. It wasn't always pretty. But he kept practicing and he got better at it, so now he can do it very well. In fact, he can do it sometimes without even paying attention. And that's kind of what it's like to practice sin and to practice righteousness. When you're doing one of them over and over and over, it gets easier. So before long, if you're lying to people and stealing things, you don't think much about it. And if you are practicing righteousness, before long, loving people and sharing your stuff and doing good unto others and praying becomes natural to you. So there's a little object lesson from basketball about practicing sin and practicing righteousness.
Good morning, and thanks for joining us this morning. Today, I want to talk to you about something that I am calling meaty teaching. As I had been reading through the book of Hebrews and had been teaching over the last 2 weeks, I am becoming more and more convinced that it's God's intention that the church embrace meaty teaching. And as I've been asking God, what do I do with this? What direction do I go? He led me to just one line from the passage we investigated last week, the idea of the teachings of righteousness. So if I could begin our journey today, I want to look back at our selection last week from Hebrews 5. It says, "Anyone who lives on milk, being still an infant, is not acquainted with the teachings about righteousness." Now that word righteousness is a word that's often bantered around. But based upon translation, it's used about 445 to approximately 619 times in the Bible. If we research it in its biblical Greek, the definition that comes back for the term righteous is a term, a condition that is morally acceptable. So a condition acceptable by God. So to teach about righteousness, or what I believe that the writer of Hebrews is attempting to bring out here, is that teachings about righteousness are teachings that emphasize the how about being in righteousness, or if we'll interchange the term right standing before God. So to teach on righteousness is to teach on how to be in right standing before God. A couple of questions. The first one I'd say today is the most important. How do we become righteous? Well, as we look in the scripture, we'll see in Isaiah 64, verse 6, all of us are like one who is unclean, and our righteous acts are as filthy rags. Did you hear it? Our righteous acts are as filthy rags. Our righteous acts, what we are capable of conjuring up within us to do what we think are good, really are not good. The scripture calls them a term that is nothing that anyone wants to keep around them. So if we're to draw a conclusion, it is that our own actions are unable to attain a state of righteousness. We can't do it. So if we can't do it, this is all the more reason why we need a Savior to be in right standing before God. Paul wrote about it in 2 Corinthians 5:21 when he said, "He made sin who knew no sin to be sin on our behalf, that we might become the righteousness of God in him." Romans 10:4 says, "Christ is the culmination, the high point, the precipice of the law, so that there may be," and here it is again, "righteousness for everyone who believes." So along these lines, I need you to understand that righteousness, it begins with God. In his desire for fellowship with man, he created man in right standing with him. But we know what man did. Adam and Eve took the fruit of the tree, they brought it down, and innocence was lost. But it's beyond innocence. Their position of right standing was lost. And in that position of right standing being lost, there was a break in the fellowship. So here is God who created Adam and Eve in proxy all of mankind for right fellowship. He now sees the need, or he sees the need actually before Adam and Eve even sin. He sees the need for there to be right standing. It results from a broken relationship. He desires a restored relationship. So he offers Jesus as the propitiation for sin. What does that mean? It means all of the wrath that you and I deserve falls upon Jesus. And because it fell on Jesus, the sacrifice, the atonement for justice has been paid once again. Because of Jesus, we are offered right standing with God. Now, here's this little thing God gave us. It's called free will. In free will, we have a choice. We can say yes to self and no to God, or we can say yes to God and no to self. God wants us to not be compelled by an overwhelming nature to accept him. He wants us to accept him from love. And so he offers this free will choice. And he accepts man to respond to the offering in reciprocation, because Jesus paid it all so that we could be in relationship. We respond accordingly. Well, here's the thing. Once Jesus paid it all and we have responded accordingly, we are placed in right standing with God. Now, the only thing that separates us from that right standing after conversion is a three-letter word called sin. The only thing that separates us from that right standing is a three-letter word called sin. We see this demonstrated from the beginning. Adam and Eve sinned, and they were removed from God's presence, and they were excommunicated from the garden. When the people of the earth were so deep in sin, God sent the flood, severed their lives, severed whatever relationship was there except for Noah and his family. The people of Israel were God's chosen people, yet they too chose to live in sin. And because they chose to live in sin, too often what occurred is they were placed in captivity. How about Jonah? Jonah had a relationship with God where he was to be God's emissary to the most wicked of people. Jonah was his own judge and decided the people of Nineveh didn't deserve it. And so he ran, and God caught up with him and swallowed him with a great fish. Here's the point. The state of the person was changed because they allowed sin to change their right standing before God. Now, please understand, I don't believe that God changed the standing. Sin and man's response changes his standing of righteousness before God. And we'll see it even in a greater sense post the death and resurrection of Jesus in the New Testament. I want you to look at Hebrews 10:10, where it says, "By that will, we have been sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ." And I love these words, "once for all." Once for all. What does that mean? It literally means that Christ's sacrifice has assured that all sin has been forgiven. It is taken care of once for all. Any doubt? Let me continue. 10:18 of Hebrews. "And when sins have been forgiven, there is no more need to offer any more sacrifice." Why? Go back 8 verses. "Because what Jesus did has paid for sin once for all." So sin is forgiven. For the believer, it is forgiven. Now, keeping that in mind, our second question today is, what ensured our state of righteousness? Now, remember, God created man in right standing. Man sinned. God sends Jesus to die on the cross to restore man to right standing. God, if I had a third hand, it would come over here. He gives man the gift of free will, and he expects that man will utilize that free will to reciprocate what God has given to man. So, we're now to the second question. What ensured our state of righteousness? So, when Jesus died on the cross, past sin, present sin, and future sin is forgiven. It's all for the believer been covered by the blood. All sin has been paid for by what Jesus did on the cross for the believer. So the cross did two things. The cross changed the sacrificial paradigm by which people would come and they would bring an offering. And that offering, that I believe that sin offering, was an offering that was presented once a year by the family, and it would cover their sin for what was going on right now, what had happened for the previous year, and the year to come. And the next year, they would offer one again, and it would take care of what had happened in the past, what was happening now, and the year to come. So this issue of the sin offering covering past, present, and future is something that we see modeled in the Old Testament. But once Jesus died on the cross, what happened was it also changed the way God would address sin from that point on. Now, I'm going to try to blow your mind here for just a minute, because a lot of this has not been taught, because I believe a lot of what we have been taught is very milk teaching. Let me take this into depth. If you are a believer, God is no longer in the forgiving business. Here's the deal. You have been forgiven. Your acceptance
of what Jesus did on the cross ensures that from God's end to you, you are in right standing with him. So to make it very practical, you don't have to offer a new sacrifice for a new sin. Justice for you has been satisfied when Jesus bowed his head and he spoke out those words, "It is finished." So you do not have to be forgiven one sacrifice for one sin. Sin is already atoned for. However, God is bent on keeping you in relationship with him. So God is in the business, not the forgiving business for the believer, but the repentance business for the believer. Now, are you saying, well, are you arguing semantics with me, Aaron? I would argue no. You see, forgiveness is about, God, I have sinned, and I need a savior. I need something to pay the price for what has happened. I need to be made right with you in what has occurred. If you've already been made right because of what Jesus did on the cross, then where does the fault lie? It doesn't lie with God, lies with you, lies with me. And so the picture here is what are we essentially doing when we're saying, God, forgive me? We are essentially saying, God, help me to take the viewpoint that I presently have, the viewpoint that is leading me astray of you, and help me to turn it around, to now look face to face with God and begin to go his direction again. See, God's not interested in us saying we're sorry. Remember the story of the prodigal son. He just had to show up, and God, or his father in this case, restored him. I believe there's a visual picture in that. That all we have to do is turn around and come back, and we again are placed in right standing. Folks, I want to stress something to you. It is time we as the church end our love affair with the yo-yo Jesus. And here's what I mean by that. We go, now I have my salvation. Now I don't, I was bad. Now I have my salvation. Now I don't, I was bad. Now I have my salvation. Now I don't, I was bad. Do you understand what that breeds? That breeds fear in your life, as if somehow you can do something that makes you greater than the sacrifice of Jesus Christ. It breeds fear in your life that you have to be so perfect that you can't fail, because if you fail, it doesn't really matter that the greater majority of who you are is being poured out before the Lord. You fail once, you can lose it all, and you could go to hell. I would challenge you instead to have a love affair with the grace of Jesus. And what does that look like? Well, Paul writes about it in Hebrews 13, verse 5, when he says, I will never leave you or forsake you. The Lord is my helper, and I need not be afraid. What can man do to me? Let's deal with that. What can man do to me? Is Aaron a man? Yes. Can Aaron screw his life up so badly that God goes, I'm out? No. No, he can't. See, grace is based upon agape love, unmerited favor. When Jesus died, it was finished. Favor was given. And here's the deal. Our righteousness is either about holding on and embracing that favor. Our lack of righteousness would be about letting it go. So let's go to the next question. Is what you're explaining to me, Aaron, the difference between the old and new covenant? The answer to that question is yes. You see, in the old covenant, righteousness was based upon good standing that you received through a yearly cleansing of sacrificial blood. You did that, you obey the rules, and you were righteous. Now, in the new covenant, Righteousness is based on the once-for-all cleansing of Jesus, or once-for-all sacrifice of Jesus Christ, and its subsequent cleansing, which leads to lifestyle change. Let me explain. In Hebrews chapter 10, 1 through 3, it says, "The law is only a shadow of the good things that are coming, not the realities themselves. For this reason, it can never, by the same sacrifice repeated endlessly year after year, make perfect those who draw near in worship. Otherwise, would they have stopped being offered? For the worshipers would have been cleansed once for all, and they would no longer have guilt for their sins. But those sacrifices are an annual reminder of sins. It is impossible," say that with me, "it is impossible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sin." Let's look at Hebrews 8, 3 through 5. God did by sending his own son in the likeness of sinful flesh to be a sin offering. And so he condemned sin in the flesh in order that the righteous requirement of the law might be met in us who did not live according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. We'll break it down for just a moment. The Hebrews passage basically brings out two points. The law, which we could perhaps reword by saying it's our best action trying to earn status with God, could never make us righteous. The writer of Hebrews was going, ain't going to happen. It's impossible. He said, remember, it is impossible for the yearly sacrifice to take away sin. If we have sin, we are out of right standing with God. Go to the Romans passage. The Romans passage shows us that Jesus was sent as the sin offering. So when Jesus is sent as the sin offering, the offering that Hebrews tells us was once for all, no other sacrifice is needed, then the righteous requirement of the law has been met. Justice has been atoned for, which allows for you and I to be in a state of righteousness, but be cognizant here that that righteousness is about living by the Spirit. So God can offer us righteousness through Jesus. Jesus can secure our righteousness, but our standing from our part can be broken because we do not live according to the Spirit. You see, living according to the Spirit prompts us to live according to the things of God. We think His will and His way. When we do, we fulfill our part for right standing. When we don't, we can lose the standing and we can lose the fellowship for two simple reasons. One, we lose our focus on the one who has given it to us. So the kind of the deal here is we don't show up. But number two, we lose our dependence on Him for the lie that has been spoken into our ear and we have received it. Who speaks that lie? The devil who cannot tell any truth, will try to convince you there is a better way and a more satisfying way apart from God. You don't need His righteousness. And the resulting situation you will find yourself in is this. Lack of standing is not on God. Lack of standing is on us. So if we find ourselves in lack of standing, God is not asking for you to say, "Oh God, please forgive me for my lack of standing." He is waiting for you to go, "I know what you did, and it is enough for me. So I am going to do a 180. I am going to turn around from where I had been going when I was trying to find satisfaction of my own and I was journeying away from you. I'm going to turn around and journey toward you." And what happens when you turn around and you journey towards Him is God will give you this visual picture of the cross all over again, and you will say, "I believe it is enough for me. It's the awakening again that the prodigal got when he looked at the things that were, he was feeding the pigs and no one took care of him. And he went, I believe that when I go to my father, even if I live as a servant, I will be taken care of. And so what happens? The prodigal acted. In our case, we act. And then God does something. He wants for us to so badly stay in fellowship. He causes a course correction. He helps us to repent. When we repent, we revisit the cross, we view the miracle all over again, and we are made aware of the reality of its finished work, and it is well. So let me wrap it up with this. What does righteousness mean to me? Well, number one, you can't earn it. You can't do anything to improve your state of it. It is because of God's grace that Jesus was sent to allow you the hope of right standing. Number two, righteousness or right standing is like the key that opens the door. It has been given to you. Use it, and you'll be in fellowship, which means you will reap the benefits of that relationship. And if we look at the benefits of that relationship, I want to maybe just break it down to the most simple benefit. Romans tells us that all creation reveals the existence of God so that man is without excuse. This means that all creation points us to the reality that there is a God and that he matters. So when we think about the benefit of relationship, think of it this way, that the God who is the instrument by which all things are held together, he is the giver of every good thing according to the book of James. He is the giver of life, and I guess I would be redundant if I just went through this. The point basically is this. He cares about a friendship with you and with me. So we get to have intimate communication with the God of creation, who for love's sake created you to be with him. What further benefits would you think there would be beyond that? I'd like you to think about it. If we go further and we think of those benefits, we want to be in right standing because we want those benefits in ever-increasing detail. I must embrace my role then, if I want them in ever-increasing detail, I must embrace my role to learn more and to be obedient to more of God's word. I don't want to hinder my standing with him. I don't want to hinder my fellowship with him. And so when he says, I want you to have the meaty things of the word feeding your soul, I got to know what those meaty things are. Finally, if I don't, what will happen is when I walk away from where he wants me to be, when I walk away from my good standing, when I walk away from fellowship, every part of me that has been invigorated by God by being in good standing begins to stagnate. If I'm careful then not to repent, what once was a miracle will turn into a chore, will become a heavy burden. And folks, the frankness of this is who wants a relationship burden? I close with this. The writer of the Hebrews was clear. You are on milk because you are not acquainted with the teachings of righteousness. You need meat to mature. My hope for preaching is always this, that what is of Aaron will fade off like chaff on the wheat, and the seed will remain. My prayer for you today is that this teaching brings understanding on obtaining and maintaining righteousness or your right standing with God as the pathway to greater meat in your spiritual diet, that we may see, as the scripture says, a glorious church without spot or wrinkle, washed in the blood of the Lamb. God bless you.
In 2012, we were living paycheck to paycheck like many families, stressed out about money and wondering if things would ever get better. Neither of us could really let ourselves dream of retirement because we had to focus on the next bill cycle. We had it in our hearts to give, but basically gave to God what was left at the end of the month because we could not see another way. Then we signed up for Financial Peace University, offered at the church, to see what the Bible had to say about finances. Wow, we found out that what God tells us about finances and what the world tells us are very different. It took a while to all sink in. About 6 months later, we sat down and looked at each other. Did we really believe that all good things come from God? That all of this belongs to Him anyway? Were we inviting Him to be a part of our finances, or were we only trusting Him in the less risky areas of our lives? We made a commitment that day to tithe 10% to the church and put God as the number one line item on our monthly budget. This decision has changed us and our hopes for the future in a big way. Today we are actually bringing in a lower amount compared to back then, but it seems to spread further now. I will admit, some months writing that check is hard. The months when it could go to replacing the breaking down couch, car repairs, or soccer fees for the kids. But when we truly grasp that all we have comes from Him, and this is a small way that we can show our love and trust in Him, it starts to bring joy to write that check. Somehow, we've been able to tithe, meet the needs of our large family, sponsor an additional child, and work on paying off debt since we made this commitment to God. God has found a way to stretch our modest income in ways we never dreamed of before. What blessings we see when we invite Him into our parenting, our marriages, our friendships. Inviting Him to be a part of our finances was the next step, and we have not regretted it.
Hi everyone, Pastor Aaron here outside of the church, just wanting to say goodbye to you. I want to thank you for listening to the broadcast, and I want to thank you for pondering some of the things that you've been given. I truly believe that God's intention is for the church to be beyond milk, and I'm certainly not the only person who's offering meat, but I would encourage you, do your best to transform from milk to meat in your life. Do your best to give God that level of access. Do your best to let Him change and tweak your thinking so that in the end of this, all that God intended from the Christian life can be yours. Again, my name is Aaron. If you'd like to contact me, our number is 618-544-7531. I'd love to talk to you more. God bless. Have a great day.